I want to talk to you a little bit this afternoon about the peer leadership program that the Wellesley Interact Club has been doing, and share with you a bit about the Break Free from Depression curriculum, because it has been one of the examples of ways that Interact clubs have been able to really begin conversations specifically around mental health related topics. Now, I definitely want to underscore that you do not have to do this curriculum as part of being an Interact club, but we're sharing it with you for a couple of reasons. One, hoping that you'll gain some information about what depression is about and about depression prevention, and maybe about learning some skills about initiating conversations about this, right? So really focusing on that message that you all have been talking about, establishing safety in your community, opening up lines of communication, and really seeing each other's point of view. So the Break Free from Depression curriculum was actually created, I started working on this back in 2006, and again, the reason for this was really thinking about how can we be more preventive, right? Instead of waiting until somebody's really experiencing depression, how can we figure out what's going on earlier? So how can we have more awareness, and how can we have better early intervention? The other piece that we hoped would happen through this curriculum is that it would allow us to be able to have really open conversations about the topic, right? How many of you generally talk to people about emotional concerns outside, if that's your job? Do you guys ever talk about emotional issues to each other, to other people? Yeah, is it easy? How is it? Is it easy? Is it hard? What's your experience been like? I asked, you know, people that are closer to my age, how often did you talk about this, or did you talk about it in schools? And the answer was no. There wasn't a whole lot of conversation about it. And we're really hoping that this will change. We're hoping that, you know, our conversations don't only involve what the outcomes are or how well you did in something or not, but also what that process was like for you, what emotions are going into that, and how you can really connect with people when you're having a hard time and when you're having a good time. So we're really hoping that this kind of involvement from Interact and talking about wellness and talking about emotional health will help to really promote a lot of these conversations. So how can you as Interact members find ways to do this? I'll tell you how the Wellesley chapter did it. But one thing I would tell you is find advocates that really want to help you in this. Find people that really want to be champions in this with you. Lisa just joined us. Lisa Siegel I've known for a long time, and she's been a wonderful advocate for our kids and a lot of kids in the Wellesley community to be able to talk about this topic when maybe it didn't feel so okay to talk about it. So find advocates in your community, find parents, school folks who can help you do this. The other thing that I can say is find opportunities for you to talk to other peers about it. You noticed when our Interact president and secretary were talking about, were showing you their beautiful slides, they were able to reach all of the freshmen from Wellesley High School. That's really amazing. And I'm thinking, find out if you can reach middle school students. See if you can find programs where you can promote wellness with elementary school students. I didn't know that there was an elementary school version of Interact. That's fantastic, because when we're really thinking about prevention, that's a great way to go to really start early. So I encourage you to find these opportunities that are right there and ready, because they'll listen to you, right? The elementary school kids are going to be so excited to see the high school kids coming to see them and talk to them, the middle school students too. And as a matter of fact, this is how this curriculum was born, because I used to go around to a lot of schools and I would talk to them about depression, and I became known as the depression lady, which was fine, whatever. But the one thing I would always be asked was, can you bring somebody our age who actually knows what's happening right now in our school, or can you bring somebody who's our age who's experienced this so we can hear it from their words? And that's actually how the documentary was born, so that people could hear it from contemporary perspectives. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you kind of the quick version of the introduction to the curriculum. Usually when we do a train-the-trainer session, it takes a good 3 to 4 hours because there's a lot of information to be able to really take in. But what I want to do is introduce you to the core concepts. I want to show you the documentary because I think really experiencing it by watching a documentary is an important thing, especially if you're considering using the curriculum. And then I want us to think about some of the ways that we can help each other, right? Ways to help yourself and others. A couple of things that I want to mention. Sometimes when we're talking about big topics like anxiety and depression and suicide, people might worry with some of the gremlins, as Jeff was mentioning, what might be, I don't know what I'm talking about, so how can I go talk to somebody else? Or what if by saying this, I'm making it worse, or I'm actually introducing ideas to people that, you know, maybe I shouldn't. So I want to reassure you that actually what the research tells us is that establishing communication and these conversations is actually really, really important and helpful. By giving accurate information, and by giving ways and ways to manage that and resources, you're not introducing ideas that will be harmful to people. As a matter of fact, you're introducing new ways of seeing things, new ways of coping. So it's really important for us to feel like, you know what? What we're doing out there is not to be therapists, right? So for the Interact teens that facilitated this, our expectation was not that they would become therapists. Our expectation was not that they would hold on to the secrets or emotions of everybody. And our expectation was not that they would fix everything, but our expectation was that they would offer a community that felt safe and that did not feel judgmental when they talked about these really, really important issues. Does that make sense? Is there anything you might want to add about that? Or?
No, I think that's pretty much sums it up. Okay. I think one thing that we really try to do is, like, don't necessarily try to, I guess, diagnose yourself when we do the curriculum, because
right.
We do talk about, like, the symptoms of depression and how to recognize them. And I think one of the slides in there is sort of the spectrum of depression, so making sure your audience is aware that we're trying to educate you on how to recognize symptoms, and that doesn't necessarily mean that because you're having a bad day or you're not feeling like your best that day, it doesn't mean you're depressed.
Exactly. So thank you. That's an excellent point. We're not going out there to diagnose, and we certainly don't want people self-diagnosing. The point is to go out and share information that will hopefully make you understand either your own experience or somebody else's experience a little bit better. Yes?
Do you think, clubs like Interact that are doing things for other people or for a goal greater than themselves, and that a person's perspective is not on themselves but on that thing, do you think that in itself is helpful for mental health kind of thing?
Yes, absolutely. So, I'm sure a lot of you have heard, like, how can I increase my resilience, right? 10 things you have to do to be resilient and so on. Resilience really speaks to not just being able to do everything well. That's not the definition. Resilience is being able to learn and grow and acknowledge feelings and grow from them. One of the things that really promotes resilience is engaging in something that's very meaningful and that's kind of bigger than yourself.
Right? So you're thinking of that.
So you're thinking of other people, you're really engaged in something that you believe in, and you're engaged in something that ultimately brings benefit to the people that you're working with, but also to you. So yes, I'm a very big believer in that kind of work, because I really do think it promotes resilience. Absolutely. So you should all have a handout. And what we're going to do is we're going to talk through these main slide points. So let me get you this big slide up here. Okay. So why is it that we're talking about depression? Why are we choosing this particular topic? Why are we addressing it at this level? Well, you know, there's still a lot of stigma related to things that have to do with mental illness. I think we've gotten better. I think that we're tolerating conversations better, and I think we're being a little bit more open. But there's still a lot of concern and fear about what having a mental illness means. So I'll give you an example. I went to a school and I asked a class, what would you rather have, a non-fatal heart attack or depression? What do you think they chose? The heart attack. Yeah, because the heart attack, you get over the heart attack, you're strong, right? It shows how strong and resilient you are. People, you know, want to help you, and they nurture you because you're physically sick. But they were worried that with depression, they might be labeled in particular ways, or it would somehow impede their ability to succeed in the future. And so there are a lot of questions and a lot of misinformation about what having a mental illness means that I think prevent people from talking to one another openly about it. I think perhaps contribute to them feeling more isolated and silent. But in fact, if we actually take a look around the room. Let's do something. Raise your hand, please, if you know someone or if you yourself have struggled with any mental health issues. Okay, so look at, did you see this? Everybody around the room, it's really something that impacts us all. So one of the things that we need to do is to stop these this isolation that happens for people, and instead be able to talk more about, you know, this is happening for you, this is happening for me too. How can we help each other, and how can we find ways to feel better? So we know that for teenagers specifically, about 2 million American teens are going to experience depression each year. However, of those, only about 40% at best are receiving treatment, okay? So that means that there's a huge proportion of people who are really struggling, but not an amount that to me is acceptable of people that are actually getting treatment. So we need to do things like this to actually have more early identification to really promote treatment. An estimated 1 out of 5 adolescents will experience depression before the age of 19. And we know that every year, approximately 2% of American teens will have made a suicide attempt that requires medical attention. Okay. Those are really big numbers. And what I would like to see is actually not taking a look at this data once we've hit this crisis point, but instead, I would like for us to all be working together so that the data we see is, you know, 50 million teens were able to participate in a program that helped them with their emotional health and wellness. Or all of the schools in the United States are actually implementing ways to help teens manage their stress related to school. So this is why we're talking about it now, and this is why it's really so important. Any questions about that? Are you guys surprised about those numbers? No? You are surprised? Yeah. Okay. So, all right, bear with me. I'm just going to skip through some of these. Okay. So Hannah and Lindsay mentioned the biopsychosocial model of depression earlier. And so I just want to go into a little bit of time to explain this to you, because a lot of times our inclination is to say, oh my goodness, somebody's struggling with depression. what happened? Like, what was that one thing that led to the depression? And quite often, it's not just one thing that leads to depression, but it's actually an interaction of risk factors that get us to a place where it really taps our ability to cope emotionally. From a biological perspective, for example, we know that people who struggle with mood disorders and people who have a lot of history of that in their families are at higher risk. It doesn't mean that they absolutely will develop it, but there's a higher risk towards having a mood disorder, for example. People who struggle with chronic illnesses might also be more susceptible. And so it's important to think, what do we bring from a biological perspective? From a social perspective, risk factors include things like divorce in the family, big separations or losses, like losing a loved one, for example. If there are stressors in the community, if there are stressors within the home, like financial loss and so on. And from a psychological perspective, there are a lot of risk factors, including things like having negative thought patterns, so thinking negatively about yourself or your future, a lack of coping skills, right? So sometimes we have all of these feelings, but we are not quite sure what to do with them. So one of the things that's really important for us to think about is, how do we build that up so that we can increase our protective factors? And if you're really struggling with self-esteem, if you're really struggling with your perception of yourself, taken together, all of these things form a combination that might lead to the development of a mood disorder. Now, I wish I had a magic, you know, combination. If I said two here and one here and three of these, that's what gets you there, but it doesn't work that way. So what we need to do is, if we want to really think about how to maintain our emotional health and wellness on a daily basis, we need to be thinking about all of these fears, and we need to think about, what are we doing, right? If socially things are going on, what are we doing to try to overcome that kind of adversity? You know, if I'm noticing that I'm really struggling, if I'm noticing that my stress is becoming way too much and really getting in my way, what am I doing? So what I would encourage you to do is to also think about this as a template for developing your own self-care plans. Make sure that you find different ways in these different spheres to find at least one thing to do to help you cope. Okay. Now, what are some of the symptoms associated with depression? Well, depressed or irritable mood most of the day, for nearly every day, and this is for at least 2 weeks. So, you know, sometimes it's not that very traditional kind of tearfulness presentation where you think about someone who's sad and they're just crying. It can also be, the hallmark could be irritability. So it's someone who's really kind of snapping at people unexpectedly or in a way that's not consistent with who they are. Kind of being cranky or having just a hard time, feeling very angry and on edge. And that's particularly true for adolescents. Decreased interest and pleasure in almost all things. You know, when I hear somebody saying, oh, this is so boring, I'm so bored, this is stupid, I don't want to do this. When I'm hearing a lot of things are boring, I wonder whether that means I just can't quite get pleasure from what I'm doing. I can't really find myself in any of these things. Weight loss or gain. So significant, obviously, as you're growing and as you're getting bigger, you're going to, you know, have changes in these things. But when it's something quite noticeable, we need to pay attention to those. Sleeping too much or sleeping too little. So sometimes people really struggle. Their mood brings them down so much that they sleep a whole lot. Sometimes people have a hard time just falling asleep and staying asleep. Feeling agitated or can't sit still or restless. Feeling fatigued. A sense of worthlessness or guilt. So maybe feeling like that everything that's going wrong or that things that aren't working out are because of you, right? So sometimes when people struggle with depression, they might think, you know, this project isn't going well, and I know it's because of me. I know that I'm the one who kind of brought failure to this, rather than thinking about what else might be going on that maybe it just didn't work out for this situation. Difficulty concentrating or thinking, and perhaps recurrent thoughts of death. So I want to make sure I highlight this. Not everyone who's struggling with depression will have suicidal thoughts, so it's not that one will immediately follow the other, but we know that the more severe the depression and the lack of treatment might contribute to more thoughts of suicide. Now, the important thing to remember is that sometimes we might have some of these symptoms, right? Like sometimes I might have a headache and I might not feel so well, or maybe sometimes I'm not sleeping well. It's important to think that it's actually when a lot of these things are happening, the symptoms are pretty severe, and they're not responding to any intervention, okay? So if you notice that for yourself, it's important to keep track of a couple of things, like how long is this going on? How much is it impacting me? If you notice it in somebody else, you can help to kind of keep track of how long has this been going on. You can also see how it might be impacting relationships. Okay, so, sorry, these slides were just fixed, so I'm sorry. I'm looking for one in particular that I'm not finding. Okay, here we go. So, a lot of times people ask me, well, then how do I know if it's depression or how do I know if it's stress, right? Because I'm feeling pretty stressed out a lot of the time and I'm feeling some of those things. How do I know if I've crossed the threshold from it being stress to depression? So when it's related to stress, we all have, you know, kind of ups and downs in our mood, right? Probably around 3 o'clock, you might think about 3 o'clock, you're kind of hitting a slump and you're feeling pretty low. And then we come back up, and those ups and downs are normal. We're usually quite aware that that's going on, and there's usually something that you can do, right? When it's related to stress, some of these changes that you might feel are also related to a particular situation. Maybe you have, you know, 5 projects due all within the same 2-week time frame. Maybe there's, you know, you're preparing for a really big move and you're really stressed out. But usually what happens is that when those stressors are gone, your mood goes back to normal, to pretty stable. When we're talking about depression, we're talking about something that is much more severe in terms of how long it lasts, how it impacts all areas of your life, and the fact that, you know, those usual dips feel like it's more down this way. And perhaps stressors go away, perhaps some things change, but you're still kind of feeling that way, kind of holding on to that. Does that make sense? Okay. Any questions about this? Okay. All right. So I think I have to go back this way. Okay, here we go. Now, it's really important to know that depression occurs on a continuum, right? So it's not just depression and it looks the same in everybody. There are 3 different categories. There's mild, moderate, and severe. And so for some people, having a mild depression means that they're able to function in a lot of different ways, right? Perhaps you're able to go to your work and you're able to do that. You're able to go to school. However, it feels like things are much harder to do. It really does take a toll. And sometimes you might see somebody who's able to make it through the day, but then they get home and it's like, ugh, you know, you've tapped out all of your emotional resources. For that, treatment can include things like counseling, support from trusted adults and other people, important people in your life, and from active coping skills, okay? Active coping skills means that you get yourself up and moving, that you actually force yourself to engage in some going outside, getting some fresh air, getting some exercise. Now, when we're talking about moderate depression, the symptoms are starting to now really interfere with more than just one area of your life. You might see it impacting relationships where maybe you're pulling away from people, or maybe it becomes more difficult to interact. There's a greater number of symptoms and they're more present on a daily basis. They feel a lot more frequent and recurrent. And at this point, treatment includes individual counseling. Sometimes group can be really helpful. And sometimes this is where we introduce medication to be able to help the person be a little bit more ready and receptive for the talk therapy piece. And finally, they're severe, where the symptoms are really interfering with everyday life. They're very, very frequent, intense, and suicidal thoughts might be present. And the treatment includes, again, a combination of counseling in extreme situations where one's safety is compromised, that it might include hospitalization. What I would always advocate for is that whether it's on the mild side or the severe side, it's always really important to think about what other things can you do for yourself outside of those 50 minutes of counseling or outside of that group therapy that you have. Because as important as those are, they only happen at a particular time. And so what else could you do for yourself? You know, would you be able to, for example, write in a journal so you're able to get thoughts out? Are you able to make sure that you talk to family and friends? Are you able to exercise? Because these are important things that help you on a daily basis. So one of the things I would love for you as Interact members to think about is what messages around this kind of self-care and around this really thinking about how to integrate that as a daily part of your routine, what messages can you share with other people about that? Okay, so the curriculum is broken up into four different modules. This is the first module, and it really shares a lot of factual information, right? Because we want to make sure that everybody's on the right page about our statistics, facts, that they understand what mental illness is, what they understand what depression is. But this part of the module also really seeks to reinforce some very important messages, and I want to share those with you. Okay, and these are the messages. Teens do not create their depression, right? You're not going out there doing something that makes you depressed. You're not going out there and being so dramatic that all of a sudden now you've created your depression, okay? Sometimes it's really hard to accept that you might be struggling with depression. And so we need to think about this as a very, as a long-term project. We want to invest the time in creating these communities of support and non-judgment that will allow people, when they're ready, to be able to share information, be able to talk. Anyone can develop depression. It doesn't matter what you look like, who you are, what you have, what your experiences have been, right? So sometimes people might say something like, oh, you know, they have so much. What are they worrying about? Why would they be depressed? It doesn't really matter. And so it's important for all of us to think about how can we support each other across different life experiences and situations. And you can't just get over it, right? There are a lot of messages that you get. You know, you have to keep going, you have to do your best so you can study and get your best outcomes and you can be successful. And the message that we keep hearing is, if you work hard enough, you'll get there. Well, that's not the case for depression. It doesn't mean that, you know, you're not working hard. It doesn't mean that you don't have willpower or that you don't have a strong personality if you can't get over depression. You can't do it alone. And so we don't want people to fall into that trap of thinking that if they're just strong enough, they'll be able to snap out of depression. That's not the way it works. And finally, depression is not a sign of weakness. My dad is one of the strongest people that I know, by far. And he has struggled with depression for a long time. And I always tell him, you know, your strength. I mean, every time I think about him, I'm like, he's strong in so many ways. He's overcome so many adversities. So it's really important that people receive this message. I can't underscore how many times people are so embarrassed to say anything or to share anything about their family history because they're concerned that they'll be perceived as weak. So the first module goes through a lot of this information, but really ends with these messages. Now, whether you do the depression curriculum or not as part of your interact work, I really, really want you to remember what Jeff mentioned in terms of, you know, really being self-aware of your own thoughts, helping people be aware of their own thoughts, helping to spread these messages, right? Especially if we're trying to promote emotional wellness, and to really help combat any misinformation related to emotional well-being. Okay. So, questions, thoughts about that? How did that information resonate with you? Was that new information for you? Have you had an opportunity to discuss information like that before? I'm hearing blah, 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 but I don't know where it's coming from. Have you guys had any, yeah?
Was that suicide rate the same in 1950?
Yeah, so I can't unfortunately speak to the 1950 part, but the trend that we're seeing, and by the way, I should mention that this is not just a United States phenomena, it's a world phenomena. So the World Health Organization has recognized depression as one of the leading causes of morbidity and mortality across the world for people ages 5 and older. So it's happening in a lot of different areas. Now, the World Health Organization has also indicated that by 2020, rates of mental illnesses, especially in children and teens, will increase from what we have right now. There are a lot of different ideas as to why that's going on. I do think that we have better identification and better recognition now. But I do also think that as the world evolves and circumstances become different, we get a whole new set of stressors. We get a whole, I think we have less opportunities for community. And that's, I think that's really impactful as so well.
The change of society as a whole, kind of?
Yeah, you know, one of the things that, there was a recent survey of kids in middle school and high school, and they were indicating that they felt really disconnected from schools, like emotionally disconnected from schools. I think it was only about 20-22% that said they felt like there was somebody in the school that really knew them for who they were. So I think we're struggling with the problem of this chronic disengagement and feeling alone that then is really escalating in the absence of good coping skills and support is escalating into some more serious things.
Does any of the research show that like the social media, the fact that kids spend more time communicating that way, have anything to do with them feeling alone in a sense because they're not interacting with people? I mean, I've been teaching for like 11 years and I've noticed a big change in the kids that I taught 10 years ago to the kids I'm teaching now is their ability to interact with people.
Yes.
Talk to people, look people in the eyes and, you know.
Yeah, there's a book called Alone Together and it really speaks to how, you know, we can be together, but we're really just focusing on this one thing and kind of tuning everybody out and not really together in the sense that we're mutually connected. A lot of the research around that focuses on the negative impact of bullying and sort of those, you know, people lose this sense of responsibility when they can throw something out anonymously and it can be really painful for somebody else. So there's definitely a lot of research behind like cyberbullying and the connection to people feeling really hopeless and humiliated and distressed. But I think there's also the piece that has to do with there's, we all need to learn. Somebody this morning talked about life skills. I think it was you who said life skills. And one of the important life skills that we need to have is to be able to regulate ourselves and our emotions for a moment, right? And sometimes to do that, you just need to take a moment and stop and not respond immediately. And now everything is immediate. The feedback is immediate. You can respond immediately. And I think it really gets in the way of us being able to develop enough self-awareness and regulation to be able to stop and say, you know what? I'm feeling really angry right now. I better do something to manage this before I do something that's not so smart. Well, if you have a vehicle that will allow you to send that really hateful thought right away, then you've done that. But now you're sitting there trying to figure out, like, oh, maybe I shouldn't have done that. Maybe I'm embarrassed. And then it ripples. So I think part of what we're losing is some time and ability to self-regulate. I really do. I don't have research behind that, but I have clinical, you know, kind of awareness behind that.
What about the flip side for a moment of, let's say, the benefit of social media for someone who may be shy or not have that network of friends and kind of have a more online community? Is there any positive?
So actually, yes. And so we need to make sure that we look at both sides of the possibilities. So there have been actually a lot of online tools, a lot of apps that have been recently developed to help people, for example, with social anxiety, or to help people who are struggling with mood, and they might not be able to quite get themselves to an activity, but they're able to, in their intermediate step, connect with someone online. So I don't think it's all bad. I do, however, think we need to balance the range of activities and coping that we do so that perhaps there's somebody who's really, really struggling with social anxiety. They're able to build their skills and their confidence and try it out online, but then there's that next step to generalize that behavior. Yes?
You may or may not know, but I don't know if anyone has the answer to this. I guess it's more of an idea, but as technology, like, we're never going to stop the advancement of technology, obviously. So it, as it progresses and becomes more common in our everyday life, how does that change, or how does our approach change instead of being reactionary? Like, take away your cell phone, how do we change and be proactive to change the way we're seeing social media and the online culture, I guess? It's a big... It just made me think about that when we hear both sides of that idea.
That's a really big question. Anybody, I want to throw that out to the group as well. Any ideas about that?
Pretty heavy, obviously, but you know, the thing about, like, in the next 20 years, we probably won't have papers in front of us. So we're going to be just using the same message, but asking kids to pull themselves away from technology, or I just think as a society, we've got to think about that, especially the kids that are here.
Sure.
Can I ask the kids, are you and your friends talking about, hey, this iPhone's driving me crazy? Are kids having that conversation? That's what I want. I mean, all the grown-ups are complaining about it, but we're all still addicted. But are kids talking about it? Yes, no?
I'd say no.
Not really? No. Just one.
Excuse me. Thank you.
You made a really great point earlier, is that I'm 27, so I grew up, when I was in high school, cell phones just came into our hands, pretty much. You know, it was like the first form of cell phone, the first way of communicating globally. But most of the kids that are going through high school right now, since they've been pretty much aware of their surroundings, have had a phone, or at least known what social media is, or having pretty big access to the internet, or whatever it is. So I think it's just a different approach, and I'm not sure that we know how to do it from, you know, my generation up, because we haven't had technology in our lives for all of it. It's difficult. I find it difficult every day. And I'm myself using social media and technology a lot.
Well, a couple of years ago now, I had the opportunity to go to a conference where there were a lot of people who were building apps, and you know, it was digital kids media, and they were kids that were really focusing on things for different companies focusing on apps for kids. And the really great thing was that we were able to begin a conversation about what are some things developmentally that you might want to think about when you're developing these apps, right? So you might be thinking that, okay, toddlers might like Elmo, great, and I'm not going to use that for teens, but you know, what about development-wise and social-emotional piece do you want to think about? Do you want to build an app that's only for one kid and it doesn't have any interactive components? Or might there be a way to build something that kind of promotes something that is developmentally, from a social emotional perspective, appropriate? So this might be a pretty lofty goal, but I think we need to start breaking industry silos and really thinking about how can we influence some of this thinking as technology develops. So I'm so glad to hear you guys are building apps. That's great.
How about less consuming and more innovating, even at the young age? I mean, she was talking about a STEM app, right, or science. I'm sure everyone's seen little kids use their parents' phone, or they have their own iPad or mm-hmm. whatever, and they're watching. And how about instead they were creating something, music or a video or whatever, just
yeah.
accessing those parts of the brain.
Sure, absolutely.
My husband and I had the good fortune of working for Eli Lilly when Prozac was in the process of being developed, and were sort of on the first sales team with it. And prior to that, treatment of depression was awful. I mean, it was, you know, horrific side effects, and very few people took any medication. So I think at that time, there was an explosion of people who were depressed and who started taking medication. So part of it, I think, is just raising awareness. I think it's a bit dangerous to sort of go straight to technology as potentially a source of why there may be an increase in suicides. But it's probably one piece of the puzzle. But I think we have to look at bigger pictures, including other stresses that we might be putting on.
Right, so it's going back to that model, that three parts, there are a lot of pieces that work together, right.
There's also a possibility that technology goes and breaks down the support system. To give you an example, we're sitting in a waiting room inside a doctor's office, and there's a young mother there, and she has two young children. And they must have been four and six, that kind of age. And, you know, they're waiting to be seen by the doctor. So what does the mother do? The two kids have got, when at that age, they've got technology games they're playing, but there's no communication between the mother and the kids. Excuse me? There's a breakdown of that connection. Those are the opportunities where you can't do anything else. You're waiting to see the doctor. Talk to the kids. Establish and maintain that relationship.
Yes, did you want to?
Just in response to that, I'm just playing devil's advocate a little bit. I teach in the summer, my wife works, and I stay home with the kids. So I think a lot of it, too, is just what we see, because I'm home with my kids all day, talking to them, playing with them. So we go to the park, go play, and I may take out my phone and hit the app and pay a bill. Or do something like that. So I think there's also this misconception that everybody is on it all the time, but they may just be on it. Like, maybe the parents just need a 10-minute break from their kid at that point when they're in the doctor's office. So I'm not saying that maybe there is an overuse, but also what we see, we don't
see. It's a brief snapshot.
Everything. It's just a snapshot. You know, I think that's something that we have to consider, too. There is times where I need 10 minutes to not talk to my children.
Mm-hmm.
Just
or more.
Yeah.
Just
so, I mean, I don't know.
So as you can see, I mean, there are so many factors that can really play a role in this. And what I always keep coming back to is a couple of things. One, balance, right? Because that's your self-care and your way of regulating, so then you can be on for another 6 hours with the kids, right? So balance and keeping everything in the context of relationships, right? So thinking about, all right, so I'm gonna use technology, but I also have this relationship that's really important to me, and I'm gonna put time and effort into that. So I think what, again, the message that I would love for you as Interact members to say is, how can we find ways to connect you know, in person? How can we find ways to connect, maybe technologically that might be helpful? How can we find ways to build relationships and sources of support? And how can we actively do things to, you know, think about how can we solve some of these problems? What can we do for self-care? What can we develop in these ways on a daily basis that will really help us think about our moods? But it's a lot that we're thinking about at the same time, so I really appreciate you bringing all these perspectives up. Okay, so what we're going to do next is we're going to show you the documentary. Now the documentary, just to give you a little background on it, it is based on the stories of real people who struggled with anxiety and depression and some with suicidal thoughts. Some of the documentaries related to these kinds of curricula are use actors. These are not actors that you're going to see. And we followed them over the course of about a year and a half. One of the things that we did was we conducted an evaluation to make sure that it felt safe for kids who were watching this. It didn't feel more harmful for them. So that we took really great care to make sure that the topics were portrayed accurately, safely. And the other piece is that there's just something very different in gaining an understanding about what it means to live with this when you hear it from somebody's life experience. So what I would love for you to do is if you could take a look at your handouts. There is a handout on page 4 that says Module 2, Viewing the Documentary. Why don't you take a look at those questions so you can start kind of thinking about that and maybe just jot down some responses for yourselves as you view the documentary. It is roughly 32 minutes in length. And what I would say is I encourage you to do whatever you need to do to take care of yourselves while you're watching it. So if you feel like you need to get up and stretch, please do that. If you feel like you want to stand up in the back of the room and do that, all that is fine. And then we'll take some time after to process a little bit in terms of what your thoughts were. Okay? I definitely think that you see things and you hear them a little differently than a slide with statistics would tell you, right? So if you're facilitating this, one of the things that I really recommend is having an opportunity to have people have just a little break to kind of reboot. So maybe a movement break or maybe an exercise when you can walk around the room, just so that you can allow yourself a little bit of time to process quietly. Perhaps engage your body and your mind together, and then be able to come back and really be able to process it together. Now, in the interest of time, I'm not going to have you go through a whole getting up activity, but I wonder if there might be someone who's feeling okay and comfortable sharing. Was there any particular question or any particular thought that really kept coming up for you while you were watching the documentary?
The issue of the video took you to the point that it went lower and lower into the depression. There's a critical point where these people seriously considered suicide. And you'd like to feel that there's some trigger where their friends recognize they're getting close to that point. And I can't imagine what that would be, but wouldn't it be great if there's a light that goes on and says, this person's getting really close. And I wonder whether there's the equivalent of that in terms of key words and conversations, that kind of thing.
Sure. So one of the things that we do talk about in the context of the curriculum is what are some warning signs that you might want to look for, right? And so we look at things like, of course, taking a look at how people are doing functionally. If they're really, really struggling, if they're becoming more isolated, more withdrawn. Sometimes people might find their own individual ways of saying goodbye, you know, giving away special things. Adam, actually, shortly before his death, was texting his friends saying goodbye, saying he was going to meet up with his dad. So there are different things that you can do, you know, words, listen to things like, nothing's ever going to change, so why bother? This extreme hopelessness. And I think sometimes people worry that, you know, you're thinking, oh, wow, well, what if they're not really suicidal, but here I am worrying about them. Maybe I'm making it worse if I say something to them. You won't make them worse. It's really, really important that you throw out that lifeline and that you open the conversation and say, I've been noticing, not diagnosing, not anything, but saying something like, I'm noticing that you seem really different and you seem really upset, or it seems like we haven't seen you a lot lately and I'm worried about you. Can we talk about that? Yes?
I guess I'm just really surprised that, like, this is becoming so common in young people that pediatricians aren't making more concerted effort to educate the parents about the risk factors. And I have two children of my own, and my pediatrician.
Yeah.
They could do screenings or like a questionnaire or something that could, you know, help the parents pick up on some of these things.
Yes. Yes, so there is a very big movement to really have many more screeners, you know, with things like postpartum depression, with pediatric visits, so having a routine screener even during well-child visits. But we need to do a lot more work to make sure that's instituted. Absolutely. When I took my kids to the pediatrician, they gave me the form and I filled it out, but there was no follow-up afterwards. So, you know, I guess if you fill it out and it doesn't meet a criteria, then you don't get a discussion. I think there should be a discussion anyway. Yeah.
One of the things that stood out to me, and it goes back to the question I asked about depression in the past, and you said society and stuff like that. Do you think that a lot of teens were depressed years ago, but because they all mentioned comments of people can get over it, or do you think that maybe it's just the fact that we're more aware now, so we're looking for these things, and kids will actually like say something now, and they wouldn't before? So I mean, like,
I do think depression has been present for a long time. I don't know that there was much talk about it, and I think there were probably some sanctioned ways of trying to manage it, like working too much or drinking too much, or, you know. And so I don't think it's a new phenomenon. My hope is that, you know, there have been enough generations that have gone untreated that now we can start getting generations that are recognizing it more earlier.
Well, it's just because you always hear, like, older generations, and I even catch myself sometimes, these kids, I mean, is it, you know, these kids are weaker, these kids aren't mentally tough, you know, not depressed, you know, just in general.
Yeah.
And you always hear, like, older teachers than me or older people, you know, seeing it even worse. I mean,
yeah, but you know what? It's interesting because if you sit back and you take a look at family histories and you really do a pretty detailed family history, there's a high frequency of people saying, oh yeah, I remember so-and-so had this, or I remember so-and-so had that, but I never really saw them much, or I don't know what happened, or, you know, so I think it was present. I don't know that the incidence has increased so much right now. I think it was just manifested and dealt with differently.
Yeah, because it just seems like it has really, you know, like an epidemic in a sense. You know, like it's just, but I don't know if that's just because nobody was aware, you know, it's like.
Well, I think what we need to consider now is to manage it more like a public health perspective, right? So instead of thinking about isolated pockets of people that are struggling, we need to think about everybody has emotional needs. How can we really build those up? And how can we really create communities of service that help people rather than sticking to these siloed ways of doing treatment that aren't as effective as if you have more consistent mindfulness around how to help kids through different developmental periods? And so I'm thinking, you know, what I mean by public health perspective is really thinking more prevention. So we know that there are these normative periods of development that can have higher risk, right? When you're going from elementary school to middle school, it's a different setting, you're going through puberty, there's a lot that's different. That's a moment of risk, and so let's build in more resources. When you're leaving to college, that's another transition. Let's build in, you know, targeted interventions. So I think if we follow developmental trajectories and address those moments of transitions, I think we can be a lot more successful at prevention. Yes?
I think too, as educators and interactive advisors, it's important to not just take care of the students, like academically, that they're people that are in front of us are all human beings, and to be aware of their emotional stuff is incredibly important to their experience.
Yeah.
Being a student and growing and learning how to cope with all these stresses and pressures. So, you know, if they get stressful now, just wait until they go on to the real world. I mean, but they have to learn early on how to cope with that.
Right.
Well, I guess that's kind of like I'm looking at, you know, it's trying to understand, and it's difficult to understand, I guess, if you haven't been in that, you know, state. But, you know, even as a teacher, I mean, how many times, you know, we're required to sort of be the counselor, the psychiatrist, the teacher, like, how do you decipher between somebody who's just being dramatic because they're having a bad day and somebody who is really, I know there's the science, it's long term, but it just seems like, are we overly jumping the gun with, like, it just seems like so many kids have these passes where they can just go to guidance anytime they want. How do you balance, I guess, and I'm not saying that I'm, you know, I'm not trying to talk down on
this. Yeah, no, no.
How do we balance as educators when the kid does have to stick things out, like off, like, you know what I'm saying? It's almost like we jump to protect all the kids in this way as if they could be depressed. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I do.
Like, how do we balance that so we're also teaching them responsibility,
resilience
I guess I'm saying, and cope, you know, deal with it. You're not always going to like everything you do. So
yeah.
That's where I'm struggling, and I think a lot of educators are struggling with that.
And parents,
too, yeah. Like, where's that balance? How do we do it?
Yeah.
I know in our district, they've put more and more mental health counselors in. And to me, it's kind of a no-brainer. The kids are under incredible stress. They're, the school district, I think it's a 4.5 that they strive for. The kids I've talked to find college easier than high school. And no wonder they're cracking. At the same, they just have too much expectations and all this. And I find the system currently so much more demanding than when I went to school and the dinosaur age. So, I mean, it's just an incredible amount of social, academic pressures. And I would love for there to be in the culture a conversation about the academic piece that impacts them.
Yeah. Well, that's a really complicated, big question, because I think it's a systemic question, right? There's a lot that you as teachers are expected to do, but you can't do it all alone. You need the support of your administrators, and you need parents, you need your community around you. But my thought is that it's not about using the diagnosis and saying, okay, well, now you have this diagnosis and I can't expect things of you. So it's not, you know, either or. I feel like it's understanding what temporarily these symptoms might get in the way of, and finding different ways to support the child to still be able to actively participate and cope with the challenges of school. Because I think part of treatment is to help build skills, to first of all recognize when you're having a hard time, then be able to use skills to be able to do that. And so I think it's really in the way that treatment is approached, and I think it's in the way that the expectations for them are held too. So it's not like you're damaged or broken because of this. You can still participate in class, but maybe it means that until, you know, you're feeling a little better, instead of giving you an essay exam where you have to really rely on your memory and processing, which might be a little slowed down by the depression, I can give you a multiple choice test. And you can still feel successful that you're participating in class, but I just tweak it a little bit until you get up to this point, right? And so I think we need to be mindful about things like, what are our mental health protocols in schools, right? Do we, if a kid is having a hard time, do they go to the nurse and then stay at the nurse, or is there an intervention that happens at the nurse's office and then coming back to be able to kind of take a moment, you know, re-regulate and come back to the class? So that's why I think it needs to be a systemic look at how it's handled in the school. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, we're starting a new program called PAVE that they're starting this year. And we're going to actually be asked as teachers to recommend, you know, to look for some things. That's why I'm asking, because it's kind of like, you know, it's hard. Is it just a teenager being a teenager, or is it, you know what I mean? So I just think it just seems like, you know, there's a lot of pressure on teachers as well to report.
Yeah, report. Sure.
You know, one of the fears that I was talking to the guy who is going to be running it, and one of his fears is, by allowing teachers to recommend these students, is that, are all these teachers just going to start like, okay, I can't, you know, he's acting this way, he's ruining my class, I'm, you know, like, you know, so they're kind of hesitant on how they want to approach the teachers and having them recommend students, because are we going to get an overrec? Because it's not just there's depression, anxiety, there's a bunch of things on the list,
yeah,
you know, like different warning signs, you know, and, you know, so one of the things that I think, you know, they're concerned about is, are people going to be overly sending these kids to this program?
Yeah, yeah, you know, it's a valid concern.
They're looking, you know, for, you know, so if you could be able to take something back to him on how we could.
So I want to come back to something that your team brought up during the PIP exercise, which was around how to just have questions posed about how are you doing, you know, and to facilitate that conversation between teachers and students. Because one of the things that the research does say is that a really meaningful connection and relationship with teachers can actually buffer the negative effects of some really hard things that might be going on at home, or can really play a key role in terms of facilitating improvement when a student is struggling emotionally. And it doesn't have to be treatment related or, you know, cutting them slack. It's just about the strength of the relationship. So I think part of, you know, when I hear your concern about maybe the teachers are just going to download some of the students because they're giving them a hard time in class, I think there has to be a piece around warning signs and all that, but also a piece about how do we build relationships with the students and how can we support the teachers in feeling like I have time in my classroom for 5 minutes to kind of check in and see how people are and connect meaningfully before I have to move on to my lesson. So I think it has to come from both perspectives too, supporting the emotional needs of the teachers too.
So would you recommend the teachers talk to them before they implement the program and kind of, if that's a, you know, if it's just implemented with the teacher just receiving something saying, here's a, you know, so maybe that would be something I could suggest.
Yeah,
discussing protocols and
discussing protocols.
Things that we need like you said, 5 minutes, or, you know, if you're coming in to evaluate us, don't expect every minute of the classroom to be instruction the way you want to see it if we're supposed to be looking for these things as well.
Right, and also, I think, what are the teachers' perceptions about this program? Right, you need to know.
I don't think they even know about it yet. Do they know about it?
So I would definitely recommend that conversation before it's implemented, because I think you'll get a lot more buy-in and just being able to address these questions that you're talking about, which are really valid. And maybe there are some teachers that are really amazing at forming these relationships and communication, but maybe they feel like that's going to be hindered because of the program and they have to do it a different way. Yeah. And, you know? So.
But I wonder if they could have, like, certain teachers that do have those relationships, like, be part of the team.
Like, you could have, like, mentoring teams, you know? Those teachers that really feel comfortable with that and believe in that, helping younger teachers or other teachers that might not feel as comfortable. Yeah.
I agree that finding the right format is the way to approach this. Because in different districts, in different schools, it might be that different formats are going to be more helpful. For example, in our district, in our high school, they've been good in that for the last several years to raise awareness about depression, stress, all sorts of addictions. They do have several times per year open forums. They bring speakers, keynote speakers, and all that. But there is no, it seems like there is no continuity to that. And it becomes this vicious circle that the same school that has these high expectations from all the students to perform the best, that same school obviously experiences the problems of the kids being stressed and getting depressed. And they try to help them, but it only appears to be several separate acts of helping. It's not like a whole program or a real addressing the problem, the root of the problem.
218.
So my take on this is that the format that would help in your school, that would be appropriate in your school, might not be appropriate in our school district over there.
So, we could probably have this discussion for a long time, and I really appreciate that that you're thinking about this not just in the context of this tool itself, but in the context of how tools are used in a bigger system and what approaches are most helpful to be able to deliver the information. I have to agree that I don't think one-shot deals work, so I think it has to be really thinking about how can we provide ongoing support. Okay, so we're coming to the end of the day here. So I just wanted to check in with everybody. Is everybody all right? How are we doing? We're good? We're good? Okay. So I'm going to walk you very, very quickly through the next two modules. Module two, three, is usually done on the same day after people have had a chance to see the documentary. And it's really an opportunity for people to get together in groups, have further discussions, very much like what we just did about the documentary, and then re-emphasize some learning pieces. Okay? Oops. So, for example, true or false, what do you think about this statement? Approximately one-third of adolescents with major depression also suffer from another mental illness. Is that true or false? True? Yell it out. Come on, guys. It's your turn. Yell it out. True, false? False? True? It's false. Do you know why it's false? Two-thirds. Two-thirds. Yeah. So two-thirds. So anxiety and substance abuse disorders are very much in co-occurrence with mood disorders. Okay. Let's see. Once people are diagnosed with a mental illness, they will never recover.
False.
You got to say it louder.
False.
That's right. It is false. And this is a really important message to be able to share. Okay? How about this? Suicide is a second leading cause of death for people ages 15 to 24 and among college students.
True.
False. It's the first.
Probably the first. I would say the first.
It's true.
What's the first?
Accidents. Accident is the first. Okay, and how about this one? If you ask someone about suicide, you will be putting ideas in their head.
False.
Excellent. So, as you can see, these are some of the messages that you really want to make sure people understand. So this is further consolidated by the discussion that happens in Module 3. Okay, and then moving right along. All right, so Module 4 is the module where you can really get creative, but it focuses on teaching and learning about coping skills. Now, we can give people information, right? And it's really great to have accurate information. But that, in and of itself, is not going to be as meaningful or impactful if then they don't have skills to know what to do with that information, if they don't know what to do for themselves. So what happens in the context of teaching the curriculum is that you'll help the people that you're working with to create a list of resources. So they're thinking about, who are those people in my network of supports that I can reach out to? Are there grandparents that I can reach out to? Are there uncles that I can reach out to? Is there a clergy member, a teacher that I really trust? Who can we really be able to connect with? And what words would you use to ask for help? Because a lot of times we say, well, just talk to somebody, right? Ask for help. But I don't know if any of you have been in the situation where you need to talk to someone and actually say you need help. It can be pretty challenging to find those exact words, right? Even if you're feeling like you got this, it can be really hard to be able to put it out there and use the words. So we do some role playing, and we're able to really help people build those skills. And the next one is if you're concerned about a friend. A lot of the members of Interact with whom I've worked actually, you know, have called me or emailed me, so-and-so told me that they have an eating disorder and I'm not quite sure what I should say. Or my friend told me that she's really depressed. I don't know what to say. And so really thinking about, how do you approach a friend if you're concerned about him or her? How do you use non-judgmental language so that you can invite a conversation and you're not feeling like you're diagnosing them or you're telling them what to do? And then finally, we talk about different ways of coping that you can practice, okay? And this is where, if you as the facilitators have a particular skill that you really like for yourself that you've used, maybe you do mindfulness, maybe you do yoga, maybe you like to paint, you can share those coping skills and you can actually ask people together to practice some of those things. Okay, so the fourth module is a really activity-based one, and it really encourages people to, one, create a list of resources, and two, create a list of coping skills that they can use. And very importantly, these are active coping skills, right? So passive coping is like going to sleep, locking yourself in your room, kind of avoiding or escaping the situation. Active coping is when you actually do something to try to manage how you're feeling at the moment. So we really want to promote active coping, okay? So that's like the speed version of the curriculum. Thank you very much for your attention.